here, and welcome to my review slash rant on X-Men Origins Wolverine. And yeah, this will probably be a rant. Okay, X-Men Origins Wolverine. What the heck did what went wrong with this one? The story, the script is what? What was that? Okay, on paper, an origin story for Wolverine sounds like a brilliant idea, and quite a few of the ideas that they had, or at least up to the experiment itself, that could work in a movie with the experiment as the final thing. But the experiment's not even halfway through the film, and they have still quite a lot of stuff to talk about. And this doesn't really make a lot of sense. The way Wolverine loses his memories at the end, is a bit contrived. And it doesn't really link with the original three films, which is what you would have wanted with this film. You wanted it to be a prequel to the first three. And yeah, not everything has to line up. Look at the Star Wars prequels. But at least line it up good enough that it makes a lot of sense. And in this one's case, it doesn't really work that well. I don't even know when this film's supposed to be set, 1980 or 81 or 1986. I don't know when it's supposed to be set, let alone how many years it is between films. Because I don't know. I think it's said to be 15 years before the first one, but it also implies that it's 6 years after the end of the Vietnam War, so about 1980-81, because the Vietnam War ended in 73 for the United States, because they withdrew their troops that year, and then the Wolverine's mission with the Team X team takes, I don't know how long it actually takes, maybe a few weeks. There isn't actually that much time with it. The film actually opens in 1845, in what would become Canada in 1870-75 or something. So it's not Canadian territories just yet. I'm not sure what it is. British Empire land that would become Canada. And we try to focus on some of the earlier days of James Logan. But his childhood is kind of glossed over a little bit, and whilst there's some decent bits there, although I have to say, what is that the mother's response is pretty stupid. It's just like, what are you? And not even in the kind of upset or scared manner, which you might accept. She just doesn't really care. Not really. Some pretty stupid stuff early on, but also, Sabretooth in this film is now Wolverine's brother for some reason. But okay, maybe they could do something with that. Maybe they can do a sort of a character connection between the two. But this doesn't really seem to be that much brotherly bond between the two, apart from the fact that they look out for each other throughout most of the film. Well, okay, for the first half of the film, and then later on, they, for some reason, they're supporting each other again, despite most of the film actually being them hating each other. You got the titles focus on them fighting for America in the Civil War, well, the Northern States in the Civil War, then for the United States in the First and Second World Wars, and then in the Vietnam War, where, remember where I said in the Gone with the Wind review that the Americans raped some Vietnamese women? Well, I think by the looks of it, that's what Sabretooth was going to do, until a soldier stopped him, and then he lashed out at them. For some reason, and everybody started lashing out of each other, at each other. Eventually, they're recruited by William Stryker, played by Danny Houston, who actually does a really good job here. I will say this: all the actors do great jobs in their roles, and no one actually does a bad performance. It's just how they're used as characters and actors. But no bad performance by the actors. They get recruited to be part of this special mutant team, and Stryker takes them to Lagos, where they try and steal some adamantium, and they try to find the source of where the adamantium came from, and it apparently came in a meteorite. Logan leaves because of all the amount of death and killing that there's been in this team. To be fair, he didn't really do that much in the Weapon X team, to be honest, and neither did Sabretooth until just before killing everybody, nearly everybody, at the African village. Okay, maybe we could have a few more scenes to explain this, both in the wars and with the Weapon X, the Team X segments, but no, we decide to jump to 6 years later, and he's now living in Canada with a girlfriend. And this is 17 minutes in, by the way. 17 minutes in, it decides to just jump 6 years. Wolverine's now living with a girlfriend, who turns out to be the mutant Silver Fox, I believe. And Victor Sabretooth is going around killing old members of the team. For some reason, Dominic Monaghue, by the way, from, I think he was in the Lord of the Rings films, he just has a blink and you'll miss it couple of scenes. He basically is just there. You could have cut him out and he wouldn't have made much of a difference. He's just there. Hardly anything for him to do. Then Stryker wants Wolverine to join him on a mission, but he refuses. Then we get to this scene where Wolverine and Silver Fox talk about the moon, some sort of folk story about the moon being lonely. By the way, if you've seen Troby Reviews' review of this film, you'll know that he mentioned that this is a bad visual aid story. And yeah, I can see his points. It's just them talking. I mean, credit to the actors for just for carrying on telling the story for the scene. But the visual aids would have helped, like in Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part 1, which was Troby's example of how you do it. And yes, in Deathly Hallows Part 1, that was a great bit with the Three Brothers story, and you had this animation that segued into the live-action bits really well at the start and the end, from the live-action bits at the start and into at the end. That was really cool. That was really great. Here, it's just people talking. Eventually, apparently Silver Fox is in league with Victor and Stryker, and they fake her death, so Wolverine goes on a revenge mission. Before we do that, I just remembered that there was a bit where she uses her powers on some guys who are blocking the way. The guys blocking the way, they were kind of dicks, and they were getting all angry about Wolverine just wanting them to move out of their way. He wasn't even being that rude to them, he was just asking them to move out of the way. He wasn't that polite, but he wasn't that rude. And they say, oh, your boyfriend's got a big mouth. But you were the ones being the arsehole, not him. You. And why were they stopping in the middle of the road on the middle of the bridge in the first place? Are they just having a conversation? Because that's stupid. That's just stupid. Stopping on the bridge, having a conversation, and then having a go at someone asking them to move. Ridiculous. Is that what you did in the 1980s, Canadian people? Stop on bridges to have a conversation and have a go at anyone who asked you to move? Jesus Christ, this movie. And then Wolverine eventually volunteers for the experiments, and he gets experimented on. And whilst I do like the lighting and the cinematography of this bit, what happens next after the experiment is quite stupid. Because Wolverine's motivations is he wants revenge on his brother for killing his girlfriend, and also for giving him a bit of a beatdown afterwards. And that's motivating him to go after Victor. And he's been given the weapon, the tools, by Stryker. But Stryker now wants to remove his memories. But that now means that Wolverine's now going to go rogue because he doesn't want his memories taken away. Don't take away the motivation. He has the motivation to work for you. You gave him the weapons, and then you just let him loose. But what in trying to erase his memories, if you fail, you've got a rogue agent. And if you succeed, you lose the motivation, full stop. And it's the former case that happens, and that is stupid. And then they decide to take him out right after they just experimented on him, and they need him. And so once he goes all loose cannon on deck, they try and have him taken out, literally. And I thought M from License to Kill was being a dick when he said he wanted Bond back, taken back to London one way or the other, implying alive or dead. Jesus Christ. And some stupid logic around with Wolverine. He supposedly gained weight, but he can still swim and he can still run and jog. Okay, and he goes to this farm where he's looked after by an old couple who then get killed by Zero, who then lies about him, Wolverine, being the one who killed the innocent people, dickhead. And then there's some action stuff when eventually Wolverine kills Zero. I will say the bit where Wolverine walks away from an explosion does look really cool. It's just a shame it looks obviously CG. And there is some really stupid CG in this film. The effects don't line up, especially the claws. They don't always line up. Some of them make sense, like the action scenes where you do need them. But for the standing alone scenes, as Troby says, save some money and get some props. Because they look really fake, especially in that bathroom scene. And a bit of a stupid bathroom scene as well. And also, I think it inspires the Amazing Spider-Man's bathroom scene as well. Also, Americans, this is a bathroom. A toilet or lavatory is not a bathroom. And whilst we're honest, this isn't related to X-Men Origins Wolverine, but aluminium is the correct way of saying aluminium, not aluminum. Yeah, this is a reference to a Honest Trailers for Sherlock, because they said, oh, we pronounce, the British pronounce it aluminium and it's aluminum. No, no, it's the other way around. Anyway, back to X-Men Origins Wolverine. So after Zero gets killed by Wolverine, a guy presents Stryker with adamantium bullets to shoot at Wolverine, as that's the only thing that'll take him down. So why didn't you give it to the mutant whose abilities is to shoot firearms, as Troby said? I'll be referencing Troby quite a lot. That doesn't make sense. And then they decide to go after Cyclops to get him in for the experiment. But why? Is that so that the films can get back into the Cyclops fans' good books after X-Men The Last Stand killed him off pointlessly? There is sort of a behind-the-scenes reason, but plot-wise, pointlessly. Is it just so that Cyclops being thrown in here is just so that those people will be happy again? Because Cyclops is in here and it gets used? Although his laser beam stuff is a bit too exaggerated. And he's pretty pointless to be there. And then eventually Wolverine teams up with Will.i.am's character. And also we have a stupid, pointless fight scene with the Blob, who's basically just there. And they go and see Remy LeBeau, aka Gambit, who I think isn't as French as he should be. There's some bits around here where Wolverine's supposed to be fighting Victor, who kills Will.i.am's character. And then Gambit, who's not finished with Wolverine because they had a little bit of a fight, he then, we get a shot of him running on top of the roof. He's obviously woken up after Wolverine knocked him down for a few seconds. And then he comes in the middle of their fighting and starts fighting Wolverine again. And they have a little bit of a fight, which is the excuse to have some really bad CGI. And it's just pointless. Either have Gambit go all out as an ally or all out as a not ally. He's just there, which makes him pointless, but at least you wouldn't have these additional pointless scenes. Eventually, they become chums, I guess, and Remy helps Wolverine get to the island, where he finds out that they tricked him into think his girlfriend's dead, and then he walks out. But when Victor nearly actually does kill Silver Fox, when he actually is actually going to do it for real, he then comes back and is really angry and takes him on. They then have to rescue her, Silver Fox's sister, who turns out to be Emma Frost. And, you know, Emma Frost hasn't really been given the best treatment in the films. I mean, she gets better treatment in X-Men First Class, but not, I mean, it is better, but it's still not amazing. And I suppose that film pretty much retcons Emma Frost's character arc in this story, because they have her in that story. She's slightly older and it's set 20 years earlier, roughly. So, that, or this is another character. Or maybe it's her daughter, I don't know. Well, she's supposed to be dead by Days of Future Past. So, and I mean the past segments, not the future ones. Somehow, I don't know if she would have been volunteered in, I don't know if she would have been drafted into the Vietnam War, or if it was just bad luck for her. And I'm going to have to turn this light on in a bit. I'll try and finish this review up before I do, before it gets too dark. So eventually Wolverine helps the kids escape, and they manage to escape. And they get rescued by Charles Xavier, who pops up for a cameo, played by Patrick Stewart once again. Woo! Although the de-aging CGI on him isn't really that great. It was better with Last Stand, but some of the shots in that scene were moving, so it would have been more difficult to do with the CGI younger Cell, younger Xavier, and younger Magneto there. In this one, it's more still moving cameras, or at least maybe some zooming in, but still kind of straight. And yeah. Eventually, Wolverine and Sabretooth battle Deadpool. Yes, Deadpool. as he is a weapon devised by Stryker. Again, like with the Emma Frosting, we're going to have another Deadpool in another, well, technically it'll be another timeline, but again, it's set at a later point in time, like we saw in Emma Frost at an earlier point in time. So, yeah, again, the Deadpool of the Deadpool films is in another timeline, but it still makes this one's inclusion irrelevant because we get another Deadpool at another point in time in another film, like we do with Emma Frost. And that, in her case, it was in the same continuity, elite continuity, so makes even less sense for her. And well, yeah, I will say this, Ryan Reynolds is still really great, and he's perfectly cast for Deadpool in the Deadpool films. He's really great as Wade Wilson. Is he actually playing Deadpool in the Deadpool bits? Because there's a character, there's someone credited as Weapon 11, unless that's for the bits where we were seeing him on the bed. In which case, Reynolds did a great job in the active moments. If not, then it was the other guy in the climax, and it was a bit of a weird climax. And Sabretooth, again, like I said, he and Wolverine are back as chums for a bit before going their separate ways, and then Wolverine helps Silver Fox on the way out. Tried to get her home with help from Remy, who goes to check up on the kid being rescued by Charles Xavier. And then Stryker shoots Wolverine in the head and makes him lose his memories because he uses the adamantium bullets. Silver Fox then dies from the bullet wound she got from earlier. And then she makes Stryker walk away before dying, presumably from her wounds. And Remy meets up with a now amnesiaed Wolverine, and yeah, they decide to just part ways on the way out, and that's where the movie ends. And screw it. Couldn't make it to the end of the review without having to turn the light on. I'm sorry. And also sorry for having to sit through a lot of darkness. Okay. X-Men Origins Wolverine. Stupid plot. There's a couple of good ideas, especially in the first 40 to 45 minutes. But they could have done well to make the entire movie to themselves. You got lots of time jumps. You got kind of glossed over scenes. You glossed over characters. Characters who don't get much development. Characters who aren't even shouldn't even be there. Well, at least are pointless to be there, like Cyclops and Emma Frost, and maybe even Gambit and the Blob. They don't even need to be there. They're just fan service. And plot makes no sense in places. It's very stupid. Logic isn't very good, especially with the whole Zero stuff. Yeah, more logic problems. And you could have the film could have stopped at Wolverine waking up at the experiments, killing a couple of people, forgetting his memories because of the trauma, and then the film could have ended here with him running off, and that would sort of tie in with the. That was time with the other films, with one and two, where we kind of saw some of that. It's a shame they didn't explain it in those films, and people had to wait for this film to pretty much explain it. And poor Wolverine would not remember on screen, at least not in the first three films. I don't know if that arc would have come to a close in The Last Stand if Bryan Singer was directing that one. But then again, that one had two big plot storylines to do anyway, so maybe it's just as well, and maybe X2 could have wrapped up the Wolverine plot. Hopefully, and I will say that the Wolverine standalone films that follow this don't really tie that up well. They just do their own different stories. But yeah, this one, it just doesn't really work. It doesn't really work as a prequel. It doesn't really work as a film, and the story just isn't it's not a very good story, and there's just not that. It's also badly made. There's some decent cinematography and some decent effects, but it's not always quite. There's quite a lot of bad CGI, and also some very fake ones, and some weak cinematography, and some very weak editing in places. It's a mess. It's a big mess. And the actors, as I said, they all do great with their characters, but especially Hugh Jackman, who is dedicated to the role of Wolverine, and he's even a producer on this one. But sadly, not even he could save the movie. I mean, he tries his best, bless him, but he doesn't save the movie. And I don't know why they decided to make Sabretooth his brother. I actually thought that was actually the case when I saw this movie for the first time. I only saw the first one beforehand. because this was at school in year 9 or 10, was it 2014? Year 10. Year 10 was 2013 to 14. So I saw this in year 10, after seeing the first film, and just before seeing Days of Future Past, and then after that would be the other films, 2, 3, First Class, and The Wolverine, and then the rest as they came out. But yeah, I thought that was actually the case, but apparently, no, that's not the case, so don't know why they did that. And yeah, it just doesn't feel right. And I don't even know when the film's set. Is it set in 1980, 81, or is it set in 1986? Because apparently it could be 1986. I've heard it could be. It just doesn't really make sense, and there's so much stuff that doesn't really make sense. Maybe some of it does by the end, and there's quite a lot that doesn't tie into the end, to the original films, and yeah, it just doesn't really work. I think this film's pretty much been ignored by continuity of later films like First Class with Emma Frost, with Deadpool, and with X-Men Apocalypse with the Weapon X stuff as well. They pretty much ignore this film with that. Then again, with Apocalypse and also with Deadpool, it is a new timeline following Days of Future Past, which was deservingly needed after this film. Yeah, so X-Men Origins Wolverine, bad film, very bad film. I mean, I had some personal enjoyment, but I can understand the ones who don't, and I have to admit, despite enjoyability in times, it's not that good. At least X-Men 3, The Last Stand, had generally good moments and generally good stuff going for it. It just wasn't completely successful. There was plenty of weak stuff as well, but it was nowhere near as bad as this one, at least on a, yeah, nowhere near as bad. So this, yeah, like I said, I had good time, but it's a bad film. No questions about it. It's a bad film. Some positives, but mostly a bad film. So I was considering a 4 out of 10, because of my enjoyment, but because it's so stupid, because it's so bad, then I will be giving X-Men Origins Wolverine a 3 out of 10. Yeah, and Troby Reviews also brings up the point that I'm making a lot more in detail. He does it a lot better. He does a really great review on that, so do check that out. But suffice to say, this film just doesn't work. I mean, there could have been stuff that would have worked and could have worked in their own movies, and there's some really good stuff in there, but on the whole, it fails. It fails as a prequel to the first three films, it fails as a standalone film, and it fails as a film. What a disappointment. And sadly, also affected the box office of the next film, X-Men First Class, which is a generally good film. It's a really great installment, and probably the best of the prequels, excluding the, well, Days of Future Past is a prequel and a sequel, so that's its own category. But out of the prequels of X-Men Origins Wolverine, X-Men First Class, X-Men Apocalypse, and X-Men Dark Phoenix, if you consider those last two prequels, then this is the strongest by far. And yeah, and so, like I said, I'm counting Days of Future Past as its own thing because there's a prequel and a sequel. But yeah, X-Men First Class. This is an amazing film, but sadly, but sadly, its box office wasn't that great for an X-Men film. I mean, it did well, but not as spectacular. And it's theorized that Origins Wolverine kind of affected that because people were either turned off by X-Men or turned off, or plus Last Stand maybe as well, or turned off with X-Men prequels. And to be honest, First Class is basically the arc coming from the idea of a X-Men Origins Magneto film. But thankfully, the film was amazing, and that means that people took more interest in the film, which allowed the Wolverine and Days of Future Past to follow, as well as Deadpool to finally get made later on because of the res of what happened to him here. And the other films in the series, although whether you count them as successful or not, is up to you. And I mean, as quality wise, not box office wise. Box office wise, oh yes, definitely, apart from maybe Dark Phoenix. But quality-wise, that's up for the debate. I know Logan would get overwhelming response of, fuck yes it did. Anyway, so that's it from X-Men Origins Wolverine. Thank you for watching. The next X-Men review will be X-Men First Class. And if this rant wasn't ranty enough for you, well, sorry, but I consider this ranty enough. Without having to go super angry or shouty or anything, I still consider it ranty enough. Anyway, that's it from me. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. Don't forget to click below to subscribe to the official Nicholas Payne Retro YouTube channel. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, Nick here, and welcome to my reviews. And we actually kind of... Then they fake the girlfriend's death, so hang on, I'll get to that in a second. By the way, a bad visual representation, according to the, by the way, if you've seen Mr., you were the ones who were, you were saying all the, because Wolverine's motivation is, empowered by, but that means he won't have, he won't have, Also, this is a bathroom, not a public ladder. And whilst we're on it, but aluminum is actually spare. Is it just so that we can redeem the filmmakers for, is it just so that we can please the Cyclops fans? Is it just so that we can get ourselves back in the Cyclops fans' good books after X-Men Origin 3? Fuck. And the camera work of the scene that happened, at least the first shot, but that will basically mean the Deadpool from this one. But the dead, well, like the Emma Frost was setting in her, was who's goes to check up on the kids being rescued by Charles. Who goes to check out? The whole Weapon X motivation. Yeah, also more and it's also not that great as a... I know Logan would probably get overwhelming responses of, oh, fuck yes. I know Logan would get overwhelmed.